Let me now describe the evolution of business incubators as we see them globally. Business incubation as a place where you admit the groups of individuals to set up large companies is not a very new notion, but it's not a very old notion either. The idea of formalizing this notion of business incubation started somewhere in 40s, primarily in the United States of America. If you see the evolution of the modern enterprise or a modern company, the companies and the legal structures around it have been evolving in the entire 19th century and early part of 20th century. So it's nothing new, it's already 150 years old. In fact, some of us will recall with chagrin that East India Company was also a company like this, became too big and created problems, but that's a different story altogether. It was realized that such companies help, on the positive side, help generation of wealth, which helps the entire population of a society. And therefore, it has always been considered a good act. And this is nothing new. I mean, if you, some of you have read Chanakya, would recall that Chanakya in his Arthashastra specifically states that one of the important responsibilities of the king is to ensure that the wealth generation happens in the population. So it's nothing new. However, the incubation, in some crude sense as we understand it, promotion of entrepreneurial activities started taking roots in 40s. Some of the earliest examples that I have been able to decipher from the recorded information is in the early 50s, establishment of sort of two environments in the United States. One, the Research Triangle Park in the vicinity of North Carolina area, and the other, of course, in the Bay Area. You have heard of Xerox initiative. Famous things about internet protocols came out of those environments there. Today, the largest number of business incubators exist in the United States. Some of them are entirely private business incubators, run for profit kind of company. Majority of them are not for profit endeavors. A large number of them are either part of academic system or are in association with the academic system. You must also appreciate that the wealth generation mechanism in the United States has been considerably propelled by the huge amount of technology R&D that happens in its vibrant educational system. The R&D that happens in the American universities is of a different class and nature for quite some time. They have been able to manage that by getting the talent across the world attracted to come to the United States and work in those areas. And those R&D initiatives in universities, American universities, work far more closely with business enterprises than similar relationship elsewhere. So this has been a very important hallmark. It was noticed even in the American system that as company becomes large, it becomes capable of managing its resources far more efficiently and therefore is capable of generating profits year after year after year. However, it does not necessarily retain the capability of doing any new innovative things in either technology or products. Not that it doesn't do so, but by and large, the ability to do any innovative new thinking is found to exist more relatively in smaller enterprise, in smaller company, in smaller startups. Reason, the smaller startups have a much greater urge to prove to the world that they are different. A large company has already established its brand. It need not prove anything to people. People accept that company, people accept that brand. They have to merely sustain it. But a smaller startup has to start by setting up a brand for which there is nothing, and therefore the innovation occurs more frequently. Such innovations leading to companies leading to large profit-making ventures You go to practically the history of every well-known American university. Stanford, for example, practically runs a virtual incubator. But the history of Stanford is aligned to the history of practically development of IT wealth generation. Earlier, it used to be the area around Boston, those of you who know that, the East Coast area, where a whole lot of things, MIT, most of you know, the wealth that is generated out of the ideas which themselves got generated in MIT and research are well known. I think somebody said that if you count the total wealth generated by those companies which came out of MIT, they will form the 26th or 29th largest economy of the world today. That's the potential that has been exploited through some of this. And incubators have had a reasonable contribution to make in this respect. Closer home, the incubation idea in Asia started again quite some time ago, but it has spread in the last decade like wildfire. On the CD, actually this is a printed document, so the list of the incubators which have been given is a fairly large list. Many of them actually are links. I mean, there are names there, so if you see the Word document, you click there, you can go to that site. But in the printout, you don't get the link. So I requested him to extract those links and put against them so that each one of you can see that. I would like you to look at these because different incubators operate differently. So you can find out what is the mechanism of different incubators, of admitting people, of mentoring them, of providing them support, charging them, etc., etc., and getting out. But one more name I would like you to list. We will not be able to take out a summary like this. I would appreciate if someone else does that. It is called the Association of Asian Business Incubators, ABI. If you do a Google search for ABI, you will get the necessary link. This is the Asian Association of Business Incubators. You will find, of course, India is there. China is there. Japan is there. Korea is there. Australia is there. Malaysia is there. And guess what? Kazakhstan is there. Kyrgyzstan is there. Every small and big country of the region understands that I must encourage the younger part of my society's population to get into understanding of wealth generation mechanisms through technology or otherwise and generate wealth for the society. There's a huge list of partner things. Each of the list, there is an association of that nation. Under that, for example, Department of Science and Technology is explicitly listed here. Under that, you'll find a lot of activities. Anybody knows exactly how many incubators operate in India today? No. Good. I thought I was the only ignorant person. The exact number is not known, and the growth has been phenomenal of late. So even if you give some number, I can genuinely say that may be true as of yesterday evening. I do not know what is happening today. Yes. For a country of 1 billion people, it is in the 20s, that is the correct number. And this is the concern that I have and many others have. Usually, the number of incubators serve a certain area and a certain population range. Just like doctors per 1,000 people. For a country with 1 billion people, I believe the number of 20s is very small. That's why I shared with you the anguish and the desire that this nation should have 100 well-run incubators. After all, incubators don't create wealth, but they create wealth-generating engines, and that is why this number should increase. So I would request you to look at the ABI site. ABI.info is the website, actually. As I said, many of these incubators are privately run as for-profit kind of organizations. Many are run as not-for-profit organizations. Many of them are run by educational institutions. And different incubators have different models for their own operations. See, there is no free lunch. That's another American saying I like very much. There is no free lunch in life. If I am getting a free lunch, that means somebody somewhere is paying for it. Now, who that somebody is the question. Usually, when you mention, for example, right at the beginning, that education must pay for itself or recover its cost. So let me transgress and get into what I was to share with you later, namely the cost of running an incubator. When I thought of running an incubator, I looked at some of the models, particularly the model at incubator in a place called St. Louis, an incubator in Texas, okay, and of course the well-known Stanford kind of philosophy, and several other incubators. And I decided that I will have this incubator running with a guaranteed revenue mechanism, which will be on monthly charges to be paid by any incubating company for the services which I render, because I need to provide some facilities, some infrastructure, I have to run. The pilot which I had planned was an IT business incubator, I'll tell you why and so on later. But this charging policy which I initiated generally required about 40 to 50,000 rupees per month of an expenditure, including of course investment, recovery and so on. So for a year it would mean about 5 to 6 lakh rupees of expenditure for any startup company. This was in 1998-1999. The money did appear slightly large, but we said anybody who want to start a business, potential of building something very large in the IT area. You remember, as Professor Zuzar Vasi said, these were the days of IT boom. I mean, I had found out from my friends who regularly visited VCs in Bay Area, and it was very atrocious. It says, you just give a name to the venture saying internet something or e-enabled something. So he says, you can even get $1 million for running e-enabled toilets, he said. That was a joke, of course, but those were the days. So he thought that should not be a problem. One of my experiences, so one group which came in when I circulated that we're setting up this pilot, a large number of people wanted to come in. And that fellow said, my father wants to meet you. Why does father want to meet me? I agreed. I had a meeting with that father. And this father said, you are encouraging these youngsters. I like the idea, but there's too much of a risk. Suppose the venture fails, so what will he do? I said, after 1 year, he has got a IIT Bombay degree, so there is no problem. That fellow will get a good job, just like he would have got a good job now. What is your problem? But this much expenditure has to be made. I said, if I understand, there are 3 or 4 of your people, and each family can definitely take some loan of 1 lakh or 2 lakh rupees, so I don't see that's a big deal. Then he came up with his real question. He says, Professor, suppose after 1 year, the venture fails. He will of course get a job, but he will start a job with a 200,000 rupees loan on his head. Tell me who will marry him. That was the biggest problem the father had. So I said, what do you mean who will marry him? He says, in our community, if a fellow is not credit worthy from day one, the marriage is going to be a difficult task. I thought about it. Then what I realized is that the ability of Indian middle class people to take risks is very low to begin with, and the ability to take the risk of failure is still lower. Failure in a venture in India is considered a distinct stigma which does not get washed out easily. That is not so in Europe and United States. If somebody fails, everybody says that's okay, he tried, didn't work, he'll try again. It doesn't work here. It did not work 10 years ago. Hopefully things are changing now. But till such time that a large number of startups fail and the society sees that it has not affected the individuals who are behind the startup, and that some of them are trying again, and that will generally take a cycle of generations, which is about 10 to 15 years. Till such time, this mentality may prevail. So I actually called up Nandan Nilekani, the Infosys chief, and Kamal Rekhi was one of the supporters of this whole idea. And I told him, I told them I have a marriage problem. They could not understand. What is a marriage to do with starting an incubator? So I explained to them. They asked me what is to do. So I said, I'm changing the model of my incubator. In my model, I will not charge anything to a startup company for 1 year. They again gave them, particularly Kamal, who has been insisting again and again on a very important principle. He says, do help them, but do not handle them too much. Otherwise, they will start acting like cocoons. They will never learn to fly. You must expose them to harsh realities of the world as early as possible. And here you are saying that you will cuddle them for a year. So he said, otherwise I can't start. So finally it was agreed, Nandan Nilekani agreed to give me a donation of 1 crore rupees, which I said I will use it for initial setup, infrastructure and initial expenses. And we announced that we will not charge anything to people, but we will hold a percentage of that company. I wanted that to be a very notional thing. I started with 3%. We shall see later when the sign and all, they explain to you how it emerged. And that is how, of course, that particular group did not get selected on some other reasons, one of which was the qualitative evaluation reason. Frankly, somebody who cannot convince his own father that it's worthwhile taking the race, how he convinces the rest of the world? He is not sure of convincing his would-be bride anyway. That's one of the worries that he has. So I'm not sure he would convince the market. And therefore, I said, nice meeting you, let's have a cup of tea, but try something else. Better take a job so that you get married very quickly, your father will be happy, you will be happy. It's not your cup of tea. Basically, saying that incubators, which have a variety of ways of operations, and it is important for you to study all of these. My own learning from seeing all these incubator models is that there is nothing like a single model fit all. There is no single answer or single model which will fit all. What worked in IIT Bombay may not work in Suratkal. What works in Suratkal may not work in Allahabad. We have to examine what will work from a better understanding of the environment. Let me give you some examples of environments that I have seen. There are engineering colleges, of course, nowadays there are 2,000 engineering colleges. And that's why I think 100 incubators is a small number. Amongst these 2,000 colleges, typically about 50 to 100 colleges are really good colleges. Many of them are state colleges, some of them are private colleges, but they're good colleges. Go back and find out the history of what the graduates of those colleges have done in the last 20 years. And you will find that there are graduates from a few colleges who become entrepreneurs in larger number and larger percent. Madhya Pradesh, the state where I come from, for example, has 5 or 6 good engineering colleges. But if you look at people passing out of Indore, is one of the places, largest number of past students are entrepreneurs, some small scale, middle scale, something like that. You take Maharashtra, College of Engineering Pune is one such place where you will find a uncannily larger percentage of entrepreneurs coming out of that. Is it only because of the college? Perhaps not. It is also because of the ethos of the city in which those colleges exist. If that city has an entrepreneurial culture, you will find more and more people are encouraged. What do we do then in cities which do not have such entrepreneurial culture at all? We have colleges where the students and their parents, the only ambition they have is that the student should get a government job, not even a government job. Why? Because that place has been worried about security of a job for a large number of decades in that place. I think these are the things that we need to factor and we need to counter. We need to build an ethos where ability to take risk is encouraged, where we suggest to the society that failure is no problem. And that if somebody fails, either one can start again or one can do something else. But this encouragement has to be given by components of the environment other than the incubator. If those components do not exist, I submit that running an incubator well would have a problem. Because then you will be running an incubator in isolation or in vacuum. This is the reason why I have invited Sunita Singh of National Entrepreneurship Network and DST, Dr. Anita is coming here. Unfortunately, Mittal and Lara Parkin, who are the basic dreamers on these, both are busy. But please listen to them in terms of the entrepreneurship promotional activities that they do. And at your places, and also at those places which you will no doubt advise your colleagues based on this course, when you conduct a similar course at your place, please ask them to imbibe those initiatives to whatever extent they can. Because it is only as a supplement to those initiatives that an incubator could become very great and useful. Without that, it will not be very easy. Because it is the spirit. See, when you incubate, as I said, you're not creating life. You're bringing life to life. The life must exist, basically. When you hatch an egg, you did not inject the life there. Life existed. It was in a dormant form, which you're bringing out. If there is no life, an incubator cannot give life. And the life is in terms of the fire in the belly, as you say, of the people. And that is why I will remind you, the individuals is the key. So although you are admitting startups to an incubator, it is always the group of the individuals. One of the activities of mentoring that I have done personally and our sign continues to do is that when a startup company is otherwise found okay for admission to the incubator, but we find some inadequacy in the composition of the team, we see too many techies, we advise them, get somebody who understands marketing, get somebody who understands finance. When we monitor the progress of a company, within 5 to 6 months, when they have actually built a technology prototype which is now ready to go, we advise them now, get an experienced CEO. Do not confuse between owning a company and running a company. If you are good, continue to run it. There are umpteen instances I have seen in the US where the original promoter who actually holds a large stake in that company is actually working as a vice president marketing if he is good at marketing. But his CTO, his CEO could be completely different, because it is the right people doing the right job which matter for taking the company forward. So that is why concentrate on the individuals, help them to build a good team. I believe if you look at the incubators and if you look at the success rates, and then you go back to those incubators and find out who were the individuals who are running those incubators and try to get stories related to those individuals. This is the unfortunate problem. Our documentation will give you a whole lot of quantity. It will very rarely tell you about the qualitative piece of information. Who are the people? I had the fortunate privilege of learning from Kamal Rekhi, Suhas Patil, Nandan Nilekani. These are the people from whom I learned. Hopefully, when I was working, there were others who perhaps saw me doing something and imbibed and added their own luster. Such series of people, Dr. Lagu, about whom we shall have a session tomorrow. He is not able to come. He will be talking to you in absentia. We have taken a 1-hour interview tomorrow. Dr. Mukta Atre and Poini Bhatt will be actually presenting to you his case. If he was not there, there would not have been any incubator. Today afternoon, a colleague of mine, Arvind Patel, who is now with our Center for Distance Engineering Education Program, he was the project manager in Crescent. Without him, there would not have been even a simplest possible infrastructure that we made. It is not only people that you have to concentrate on when you talk about startup companies, it is also the people that you have to concentrate on when you build a team to run the incubator. You cannot generally advertise people saying, I want an officer or CEO or this and that, and get good people there. You have to hunt for those people. and you get and get. I will like to mention that getting individuals rightly disposed and then some mentoring and then building them as a team is the crux of success of any incubator. Once you set it up, of course, it runs. The large number of incubators that you see, not all of them are equally successful. So before closing this session, let's define how do you measure the success rate of an incubator? How do you associate success? After, yeah, please. Successful?
Exit?
Yes.
So either selling or IPO or something?
Yes. Successful exit of any company. Fairly good definition, although it is slightly broad. What we would also like to perhaps look at is the amount of wealth that this company is able to generate, both at the time of exit and subsequent. I'll give you a familiar example. Most of us are teachers, so this will apply. We have students who pass out. One of the measures is the percentage of students who do well in the university examination. If in my state, my college has produced the toppers from that university, I'm pretty happy and sure that I'm doing a good job. However, the real branding of your institution happens when these students go out in the field and earn some name for themselves through their professional activities. IIT brand name is not created merely by us teachers or by the facilities here. It is largely created by the success stories of our past students who go out. If you want to measure in terms of the similar parameter for the success of incubators, I would submit that while this is an important and perhaps number one parameter for measuring success, but I would say wealth generation over a period. You can define this period, 10 years, 5 years, 20 years, whatever. In fact, for a startup incubator itself is a startup, there will be no period because there will be no examples. Okay. You will get these examples only over the years. It is exactly same as building an institution and its reputation. When the institution is new, when IIT Bombay was set up 50 years ago, nobody knew about IIT Bombay. There were bright students who did not come to IIT saying, what the hell is this entity, I don't understand. Let me go to VJTI. Let me go to College of Engineering, Pune. Let me go to Jabalpur. Jabalpur was one of the best known colleges in Madhya Pradesh those days. Whatever. So, but today it is exactly the other way around. It takes time to build the brand. And the brand is built by evaluation of people over a period of time. So we take this successful exit of a company as the fundamental parameter. Because if that parameter is not like, if 50% of my students are failing, then I am obviously a useless institution. Doesn't matter what those, of course, some failure may, like Bill Gates, you know, set up a $1 billion company, but that will be an exception, not a rule. Okay. But how do they proceed further? Secondly, when we say successful exit, we might want to define this successful in more quantitative terms, which can be done. But this aspect will be covered in the sessions which deal with the sign progress and so on. So I'm not emphasizing. What is important is that we measure the people when they get out and we sort of continue to measure how they are doing. For example, if a company leaves this successfully meeting all the obligations of the incubator, but in exactly 2 years it gets folded, I may not want to call it as a feather in my cap. If a company continues to do well, expands further over the next 10 years, I will say yes, that is important. It is not to belittle the people whose company folded earlier. The person may have exactly the same capability as person here. Person may have learned exactly the same thing. Market opportunities might have been different. The situation might have been different. But as far as I am concerned, I have to measure this differently. If I can produce one Infosys in 10 years, that was my ambition. when I said that if I hold 3% stock of Infosys today, I don't need research funding from any government. Kya, Professor Sharma, you agree? 3% of Infosys stock today is in fact, I can pay back government every year if I want. Okay. But that will happen once in a while. And Infosys today is most certainly not interested in giving IIT Bombay 3% of its share, even if it were to be incubated. So you have to decide what you do. We'll discuss that when I describe the history of incubation and the path to the formalism which has led to the sign issues here. But the global experiences that you have to consolidate, to sort of summarize, early 50s saw the early incubation signs. In the decade of 90s, that is the last year's 90s decade, was a phenomenal growth. In United States, 40% of the incubators are actually IT incubators. You should not be surprised because of that. Even in India, which is primarily IT seen as services, largest companies are IT services companies. If you take engineering admission, more than 50% of the students admitted to undergraduate programs in engineering in India are in computer science, IT or electronics. So the proportion and ratio roughly matches. It is very unlikely that a IT or a computer science graduate will start a machine shop. Very unlikely. Although it is quite likely that a mechanical engineering student who actually was interested in computers but did not get the computer science branch, studied throughout those 4 years more about programming and less about mechanical engineering, may start a computer engineering company. In fact, one of my first startups had a partner who was a civil engineer. Okay, we'll talk about it later.